Hey everyone, it is a beautiful late November, 68 degrees in Florida today. I've got a very cool project I'm going to start working on. I picked it up at a flea market several months ago, but I've kind of been putting it aside. I don't know a lot about these things, but let's look at what it is. This is a 1960s maybe, Milwaukee circular saw, or hand saw as some people would call them, or even skill saw, even though that's a name brand. But it's pretty beat up. The cable is dry rotted in here. It's been taped up. That's some type of artificial strain relief. I haven't tested it. I'm a little wary when the electrical cords are shot, and it's clearly been sitting in a garage for a long time. I'd rather rewire it and then test it, and after I've had a chance to clean it up a little bit. But I don't know a lot about these other than they're pretty rare. Now Milwaukee's everywhere, but in the 60s they were known for drills, not so much for woodworking tools like this. So these are not common, and it's got an interesting style to it. This is going to be a lot of fun to paint. It's red with the Milwaukee label, and then it's silver red, so this is all striped. So once this thing's cleaned up, I think it'll be gorgeous. But you can see it's had work done. It's got a mix of screws. Pretty sure that screw right there isn't real. It's not supposed to be there. There's something else that maybe went there, a post or something. Probably a post went here, and that's missing. So I may need to try to do some sourcing for some hardware. But other than screws being changed, it looks complete. So hey, let's get busy. We'll start by disassembling this thing. First thing I think I'm gonna do is take this blade off. It's sharp. Well, sort of. Sharp for an ancient blade. And I just don't want it in the way. 1/16. 1/16. So if you haven't got a spindle lock, which this apparently does not have, well, I actually should say, if you do have a spindle lock, it's pretty easy to lock them. Well, that does not want to work with the extension. You just push the spindle lock. Since I don't have a spindle lock, what you're going to do is you're going to take this up all the way and just stick it on some wood. And since the teeth are going this way, I believe this is a right hand, so we're going to go counterclockwise to loosen it. That's it. That's how you take the blades off. It's pretty simple. These pieces will obviously need to be cleaned up. I know this thing's filthy and all, but these magnetic dishes for this are fantastic. All right, so we got two Phillips, two flatheads to take this plate off. Anything else gonna move when I do that? All right, I gotta take this guy off if I can get to it. This has a lot of screws that are somewhat difficult to reach. Before I do all of this, I should probably verify that this thing works. But it's Milwaukee, and it looks like it was used up until it wasn't. It didn't just break. It looks like it was in service and they just retired it. Everybody's cordless now. I don't know when this thing was retired. Clearly a long time ago. You get to see the inside of one of these. I've never seen the inside of one of these. This will make it easier to paint too. I don't have to drag this whole saw around. I can just paint this plate, polish it, and then paint it on its own. That's kind of nice. I'm gonna put these all. That's where those go. Pretty dirty in there. A lot of dirt. There's some rubber there too. Can you see all that? Hopefully you can. All right. Yeah, that's pretty filthy. Pretty heavy layer of sawdust, which, you know, to be expected. We'll want to clean all that up. This is interesting. That's big chunk of dust and dirt. You know, these tools, like a lot of these old tools, just worked to death. No maintenance, just worked to death. Spring mechanism seems to be in good shape. Let me take this over there and shake it out in the dirt. Let's look at how to get at the cable. Let me grab the phone. I'll show you a close up. So, I think we got four screws. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the cable should be wired right into the trigger right here. Now, this is gonna be fun to polish this out. It's gonna be really hard to get in there. But hey, look at this screw here, right? So, I bet you have one of these. Here's a vintage Craftsman one. And how often have you used it? Next to never? Maybe once? Well, here we have an opportunity to use it. Oh, one has to be stuck, huh? Wow. All right, let me change angles. See if I can get a grip on this thing. Got it. So, you know, if you think you want to tackle something like this, you're watching somebody tackle it for the first time. I've never done one of these. I have no concept of what I'm going to see inside this thing. I've used these, and that's about my extent of experience with them. Never used one like this, though. All right, let's see what's in here. Okay. Here's your paper insulation shield. Here's your cord wrapped in electrical tape. Can fold this open, and there's your switch. Okay, so we'll just leave that as it is. We are only focused with this. Okay, so let's see. Pretty easy, actually. You got your hot, your cold, and your ground. Okay, now, because this is in Milwaukee, I actually have a cool flea market find, a red and black extension cable. Now, on circular saws, a lot of them would come with small cords, and you just end up immediately plugging it into a long extension cord. I'm going to do that one better here. I'm going to put an extension cord on it. So we're going to have a, how long is this cord? 25 foot cord for this guy from the base. All right, so let's cut this guy and let's tap in here. Then I'm going to use some switch cleaner. A close up of all this. It's pretty dirty still inside. Here's your trigger. Don't think I'll need to do anything with that. It feels pretty tight. These wires are all in good shape. Everything's just dirty. So I'll probably need a strain relief, which I have some. All right, I'll be back. All right, let's vacuum some of this dust out. I know we won't get all of it, but we'll get enough, at least for now. As much as I hate to destroy a brand new extension cord, this is a flea market snag that I got for $5 or so. And so we're committed now. There's no going back. All right, Let's see about how much we need. Oh, let me get the strainer. All right, let's just slide this over there. Ooh, it's a tight fit. It's a heavy cord. I think this is 14 gauge, which is enough for circles. I wouldn't put 15 tools on this cable, but one circular saw should be good. So let's just give it, I don't really need that much. All right, so we're just gonna cut the outer insulation. So that's, we're not gonna push hard. We're just gonna go lightly with these around till we start seeing through it. Doesn't take long. Starting to see through it now. All right, might be enough. And then we're gonna just kinda see if we can pull it off. Not quite, see, I didn't get right there. Let's go back, do it a little bit more. What you don't wanna do is use this to strip it and then use this to pull the other insulation off. I don't do it that way with the outer insulation simply because it can tear it. It can tear right through the other stuff. You got a little bit where I was not able to cut it. Most of it's off. Wait. Let's get in there and see if we can. Got it. Okay. All right. So, green, white, black. Pretty easy. Got enough wire here to go to green, to go to white, to go to black. I think so. Hope so, because I don't want to cut this insulation anymore. Let's get the wire strippers. We don't need a lot here. And let's see what we got. Let me take one of these. Let's take the green off. Let's look at the screw size. These probably have not been off in a long time. These reds probably work. Yep, okay. Alright. Alright, let's strip these wires. And we don't need to strip much, see? That's all we need to strip. Perhaps a little more than that, but let's see. Nope, that's good. And where it's a red crimp, so we're using the red on the pliers. And after we crimp this, we're gonna just test it. It's tight, okay? Black. And white. We're trying. Okay, good. All right. These appear to be all the same size. All right, so white goes on the inside. Let's do white. Look at that. It's interesting. This is still holding on to the screw, so it won't let go. We want it to go. Let's take this cold. Let's grab it right there. See if we can just bend this guy over. Looks like we can. All right. For hot, it's bent over. Should be able to do that just by grabbing it like that. And how about green? All right, so for green, it's also completely bent over. So let's grab it. And all right. All right, so remember, white went on the inside. Okay, back. This guy should be a lot easier because I can just hold it in place. And lastly, green, which goes there. One last check, let's make sure these are all tight. Don't want them coming loose on us. Okay, let's pull our strain relief up. I think it'll go about a little higher, like there. And let me get some contact cleaner. I'm gonna spray it in the switch. I'm just gonna use some of that to clean this, the electronics out a little bit. If it wants to work, I gotta get more of this. This can has been hurting for a long time. It doesn't really spray as much as it kind of drips. That's all we need to do for that. All right, ready to put this piece back on. That was not hard, see? You just saw how to completely rewire your Milwaukee. All right, I'm gonna take these bolts back. So all I'm gonna do to clean these bolts up is pretty easy. I'm just gonna kick on this grinder. I'm just gonna clean these bolt heads off. The polish will kind of clean them off, but this is a little quicker. That was a sidestep, but those things tend to save you a bit of time later on when you're trying to polish this thing up and the screws still look black. These appear to all be the exact same type of screw, so don't need to be particular which of the holes they go in. Snug, 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 and this guy. What I do with my, I forget what the name of these things is. There is a name for these odd screwdriver things. Easily lost, I guess, would be a good name for it because I've already lost it. It is gonna be fun polishing up inside here. All right, now I can tighten them. That's more than snug. He's tight. Tight, tight, tight. Tighter, tighter. Tighter. Well, in theory, I could actually test this. Maybe put this plate back on, maybe, and test it. I don't think I need to put this plate on to test it, but I'll do so anyway for safety. I'm all about safety. There's a guy at the local flea market that sells saw blades. And this one caught my eye because it's a Milwaukee. And it looked to be about the right size, and it is. It's exactly the right size. Okay, I decided before I put the blade back on, which I may be taking right off anyway when I go to polish it because it's going to be in the way, I better clean this thing up. Oh, it's better? So this tightens clockwise as normal because it's a right saw. If the blade's on the other side and it's a left saw, it goes counterclockwise. Don't know if I said that earlier in the video. Okay, we're tight. Put this back. I got this little stopper arm. Okay, we are actually about ready to test this thing out. Let me grab a board. Let's see how it works. Hopefully it fires up. And it's heavy. Drum roll. Not only does it work, it actually sounds good. Let's just cut across. We'll do a cut. All right. So how cool is that? When do you think the last time this actually did any cutting was? That is awesome. So, all right, well, it's saved. It works really well. I'm gonna clean the motor out a little bit and then I'm gonna get on to the phase, which, it's tedious, takes time, but a lot of people like watching it for some reason. I'm gonna polish this thing up and paint it up and get it looking hopefully, not like new, but pretty close. Let's get to it. All right, it's unplugged and ready for me to get back to work cleaning it. Let's take this piece off again and let's take the blade off, flip it, push it down on a piece of wood, and this guy's counterclockwise. Perhaps I tightened it too much. I just don't want to be working on it with that blade. Alright, so I'm going to try the steel wool and water trick first. Saves on polish. Works pretty well on aluminum wheels, factory aluminum wheels anyway. See if it's doing anything. It is. I'm going to do this top part first. You can see the black coming off of it. It's dripping right off of it. This thing hasn't been polished in a long time. Well, it's actually getting a bit chilly out. Something you don't hear very often in my videos, that's for sure. I think I have not said that in about 9 to 10 months or more. But, so I'm gonna sit in the sun here. I'm gonna go to my chemical guys heavy metal polish and steel wool. Let's see how well we can clean this up. All right, I'm gonna get a rag and wipe all this polish off. And then we'll kind of look at it. I can tell you right now, it's definitely brighter. Is it bright enough? I don't know, probably not.
this thing is really bad. This is worse than any of the other tools that I've done with the level of scratches in it. Look at how many scratches are in this thing. How many hundreds of times did this thing get thrown in the back of a truck or something? And these came with cases, but this thing was clearly not kept in a case. Alright, so it's got some shine to it. Look at how beat up it is. Wow. Wow. This paint is pretty bad. I may actually put paint... Look at this, though. Let's see if you can see this. It's interesting. Underneath this red paint appears to be black paint. That does not appear to be primer. It looks like paint. I think if someone knows the history of these things, maybe this was black. Maybe this whole thing was black. I mean, that's why this paint looks so strange. I think I'm going to use paint remover. I'm going to brush some paint remover on it. Just take some of this stuff and... been about 20 minutes or so, and as you can see, most of the paint's off, but it's still not all off. I think it's at the point now, though, where it'll come off pretty easily. I got all the paint remover off. Most of the paint came off. Enough, I think, to paint it, but before I do that, let's polish it up one more time. Polish off and see what we got. Let's compare this, which is, realistically, it's quite shiny with what the saw actually looks like. I know it doesn't look as shiny as it really is because it's so scratched up. Let's look at the saw. Let's look at the back of the saw. Do a comparison there. So. Got no shine whatsoever, and we've got shine. So the goal is to get this whole thing to look like that. And there's a lot of twists and turns, and I think I'll be using power tools. This is supposed to be black. It doesn't look like it comes off. Those appear to be rivets. I'm not going to take the rivets out, so I'll hand paint this, probably with hammered black, after everything's polished up. There's the brushes. Brushes seem to be fine.
Is there two?
Yep, there's the other one. Yep, got that one. All right, so this guy. Yep, okay. Not easy, but they came out. I guess this isn't plastic, it's metal. It's black as well. All right, let's vacuum out all that.
inside. Remember, it's not regular WD-40. You don't want to use that in a motor. This is specifically made to lubricate motors. Clean this up. This is an easy task. Just clean it up and paint it. All right, I'm gonna wipe this thing down with acetone and mask it, and that will probably be and paint it, and that'll be the last thing I can do today. This is a slow job. I just want to make sure I don't have polish and all that in here, where the sure paint's gonna go. All right, I'll be back in a minute.
I don't want to get paint all over these lines, so I've got this really skinny masking tape. Bad sign if this won't even stick to it. Try that again. Well, let's hope this tape sticks long enough for me to paint this. This is not sticky tape at all. All right, let me get some regular tape for the rest of it. This isn't gonna work for that. Well, I hope the paint sticks to this. None of the tape wants to stick to this. I don't know if it's residue from the paint remover or what, but we're taped. Should be noted, I am not priming this. I'm not priming it because I need to go over those letters with steel wool and take the red paint off. And if I prime it, I'm going to get a layer of black under there that I don't want. But I've done this many times with this paint and it's worked out well. I'm going to paint mostly straight up from the top. That dry. I'll be back to do a couple more coats and then we'll just put stuff away for the day. Now, that's a lot of red. That's about 6 coats. I moved into the last bit of sun and that's about it for the day. I've got most of the stuff cleaned up. I can't get much further. Tomorrow, if that paint's thoroughly dry, which is because I put a lot on there, we'll see about doing the letters. And we'll polish the body. I'm really happy with how things turned out today. This is a very nice old tool. It's back in working order. It's mostly cleaned up inside. I've got the front polished, but I still have the body, and that's going to take a while. It's a lot of work tomorrow, a couple hours, but in the end, it's worth it. I'll see you soon. All right, we're back. Day 2. It's a gloomy day today. It's actually raining a little bit, and it's cold, which we don't get much in Florida. But anyway, let's get back to it. So you recall when I was working on this earlier, I said don't ever spray WD-40 into the motor. So there's a reason for that, and we're going to demonstrate it here. Not by spraying WD-40 into the motor, but by showing that WD-40 is actually corrosive. So here's regular WD-40, right? So I bet some of you may or may not know that you can use WD-40 to help you polish aluminum. So without getting it into the motor, let's look at a good spot we can do it. How about right here? So we're gonna use a kind of Scotch-Brite pad and WD-40. I'm gonna try to unlock this thing. I'm gonna have to put some WD-40 on here. I'm just gonna go up and down on it for a bit. And see how that cleans it up. This won't polish it, but let's take this handle off. If it just unscrews, which it should. Let's wipe it off. All right, so see, you can feel how smooth that is compared to that. So next, what do you think's gonna happen when we hit that with some polish? Let's see. All right, here's our heavy metal polish chemical, guys. Let's see what it does. I didn't spend more than a couple minutes with that WD-40 on this. Probably could have spent a little more. Should we get this polish all over the place? We only did these two sides. You don't need to go in a circular motion for this. You can just go up and down. It's pretty clean. You can see it's starting to shine through. Almost there. This is going to be a lot of time to polish. I'll cut the film here. I'm going to put another couple coats of polish on that to get it a little bit brighter. All right, so here's unpolished. Pretty rough. You can feel it under your finger. Rough and dirty, a lot of scratches. And here's what it looks like after polishing. I mean, it's actually smooth as glass. So this is the WD-40 with the Scotch-Brite pad twice, and then four coats of polish. So you can see on something with all the different pieces and everything, it's gonna take a while. But look at the difference, how nice that looks versus, I mean, that is pretty rough. That's like sandpaper. So, worth doing. I have to figure out how I'm gonna get in these little, all these corners everywhere without disassembling this entire thing. It's gonna be interesting. But that's a task at hand, so I better get to it.
This is one of the roughest parts on there. And just look, I mean, as soon as you spray the WD-40 on, you can see it's starting to take some of that off. Try to hold this thing down. While I do it, I guess I can take it off the board for now. Maybe that'll stabilize it a bit. I mean, I guess you could not even polish it and just clean it with the WD-40 if you're going to use it a lot. A little easier to do it like this. And we saw how bad this was. So this is just WD-40. First with the Scotch-Brite, then with the steel wool. You can see the bright metal is starting to come through it. It does work. Is it faster than polish? I don't know. It's easier. Probably less expensive too. You can buy WD-40 really cheap. But is it officially approved to be used as a metal polish? No, because it's not a polish. But it is a metal cleaner and it's corrosive. So, you can see where we went from basically this to that just with WD-40. So that will make polishing this considerably easier. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over the whole saw as best I can with WD-40, steel wool, and Scotch-Brite, and get it at least cleaned everywhere like this. This is bad. Look at how bad that is. All right, we're at the point where I have pretty much polished most of it with WD-40, and it's kind of interesting to see that parts of this came out real clean. Like, look at how nice and shiny that is. Aluminum looks fantastic. I can only assume it's because it wasn't exposed to much damage, but probably taking it about as far as we can go with the WD-40. I've got the guard off, I don't know what you call that part, but the plate, the saw blade goes through. I removed that, made it a little easy to get to it, and I think the Scotch-Brite has kind of had it. But, this is the part that I actually polished. So you can see the difference. You'll get this far with WD-40, which is pretty good. And then a little bit further with polish. It's filthy right now, but let's wipe that off, you'll see. So, yeah, I mean, it actually looks pretty good. And this whole part, all of this, is just WD-40. And it looks pretty good. So I'm going to continue. I'll be back. All right, so here it is. Pretty much finished the WD-40. That's it. It's WD-40 did a lot of my job for me. It wasn't that hard. A lot easier than using polish. So on something like this, you may wonder, how come all the other videos you just use polish? Well, the other videos, I didn't have these, and in here, and in here, and in there, and in there. It's a lot of different spots. So I figured, well, it's acidic. Let's do this first. So this probably saved me a bit of time, and now I can just polish it up. Some of it looks quite good. Cleaning up this base plate here, and look at this. I mean, look, it's a big run. I thought this piece was painted black, and now I'm thinking somebody actually did that later on. So I'm probably going to just keep removing the black paint and not replace it. Got a visit from Muggsy. Reminds me not to work too hard. Always take a minute break. back to it. All right, for this base plate, I'm actually gonna hit it with sandpaper, because it's got a lot of rust on it. So I'm using a, I don't know what, but light grade, 220. I don't even know what it is. Can't say it's an old piece, but it's pretty fine grained. But just that you'll never polish this off. This is rust. Yeah, that's smooth. I'll put a coat of polish on it, just to kind of make it a little slicker. And again, with stuff like this, it all depends on how far you want to take it. If you want to spend 20 years polishing it, you can get it to look like a mirror finish. I think for me, I'm going to use this thing, so I want it to look good, but maybe I could get out the power tools and try it. Certainly speed things up a little bit. Let's go the other way. Take it off. See what we got. Did it make a huge difference? Not really. Like this, I polished this whole thing, and you know, it didn't make a big difference. I think we're probably not gonna go much further with polishing this thing. So this is about as far as we're gonna get. Overall, it looks really nice. I did polish up this piece as well, this bottom piece, but you know, how good's it gonna look? So I guess we're in the phase where we're gonna try to reassemble this thing, which also means we're in the phase where I have to kind of figure out how to reassemble this thing. Okay, somewhat out of order in the steps here, but I decided I'd film this now. So in here is your gears that would require grease. I don't know about you, but judging that this thing is 60 years old or so, it's probably a strong likelihood that the grease inside it is no good. So it looks like there's, I see two screws here, and then there's a third. Let's see if you can see it if I flip this. Right there, but there isn't a fourth, which is kind of interesting. That technically is a fourth screw holding this piece of rubber, which I have not figured out exactly what it does yet. But normally you have to take this shield off, and you see there's a snap ring in here to grease it. It almost looks like I don't have to do that. I do like this spring setup. This is great. This is a lot easier than when the spring's inside this and it can fall out and you got to make it catch. I like this spring setup better. So I think the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to take out these screws and see if I can just grease it and this whole thing just comes out on the cap. Oh boy. These are not very deep screws. This guy is. My guess is this guy has to come out as well. It's funny, these are all different screws. All three of them are different. All right, let's see what we
we got back here, make sure. Oh, the grease isn't that bad. Look at that. All right, let's get a close up. It's not great.
I expected it to be much more dried out than that. There is some old grease in there. Let's see how hard it is. Yeah, it's not great. Kind of waxy. But here's your gear. So this little gear spins this, which spins the blade. All right, let's dig all this crap out. I don't know if I have enough grease to really repack this thing with that much. I'll see how much I have. But if not, I'll have to make a quick trip to the auto parts store and get some grease.
All right. When you're digging out old grease like this, you want to wear gloves. This stuff, you know, the smell will get on your hands, and I don't know, it seems to take days for it to get off of it again. All right, I got a plastic bag here, and essentially, I'm just going to use a screwdriver to get all this old stuff up and out. You can use regular axle grease for grease fittings in a car, Molly grease. It doesn't matter. It's not particular about what type of grease. But you do want a lot of grease in there. All right, let's dig this junk out. Yeah, it doesn't look that old. I don't think it's grease from the 1960s, but it's not very good grease either. And interestingly, whoever re-greased it didn't take the old grease out. See how it kind of holds its shape there? It's kind of waxy. Okay, I don't want to be too OCD about it. I got almost everything out. I'll just go in there. Is packed full of grease. That's good. All right, you, I believe, went down there. Make sure we get these holes lined up. Which was the long screw, do you remember? I don't. It was that. greased. Let's hook up this spring. So easy. Look at it. It's such a better setup. Ah, I'm getting attacked by a mosquito. Oh my god. Good. So I know people think, oh geez, greasing these things is so hard. They're not that bad. And you know, in all honesty, how much life, extra life did I just add to this thing by doing that? All right, so your back bearing is gonna be behind this thing. I know we just put this thing on yesterday and I've already got it all dirty. Oh geez, I sat it right in a pile of dirt. But we should be able to see the rear bearing with this plate off. And I can't see it. It's back here. There's the brushes, which look okay, but I cannot get at that rear bearing from here. I didn't think so. When I had it off, I was wondering that. Felt the only thing I can probably do is just put a little bit of oil in here and let it run kind of in. Just spin the motor a bit. Okay, so we're down to one step, and that is your faceplate. Thoroughly painted. So what we're gonna do is, I'm gonna use my old steel wool trick, and I'm gonna clean the paint off just the Milwaukee parts. Okay, so let me get some extra additional masking tape. All right, so I'm gonna take a couple of pieces of tape and I'm just gonna put them right on top of the other tape just to raise up my steel wool just a little bit, and then I'm gonna lay this one down right here. I'm not gonna push it in too tight, okay? If you've been following my videos, you've seen me do this several times. So I'm going to change the camera angle and get a somewhat more comfortable position, because this does take about 10-15 minutes. All right. Take steel wool and I just take a ball of it. You just wrap it up in a ball, not too tight. And here's a good example. When you push on this, as you're going to see, you're just doing that. You're not crushing it. You're just going on top. You're just riding it. So you can feel this. I got to make sure I can see what I'm doing. You going to be able to see me? I got to make sure. I don't want to waste this footage. All right, so you're going to be able to see. Grab that out of the way. That I'm not going to do anything except just this. Okay, just let it drag across. And you see? See, this is starting to take the paint off the raised surface already. And that's what we want to do. And it now, you say, is it touching the other paint? Yeah, it is a little bit. All right. Other than a little spot on that hem down at the base, I think we're done. And there you go. All right. All right, so let's take the tape off. All right, well, it looks like I've got some more steel wool work. I won't bore you with that, but what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna run the steel wool over all these and clean the red up a bit. All right, I'll be back. I won't bore you with that step. Okay, it's all done. Red looks good, Milwaukee looks good. The only step I'm kind of working on is these holes that somebody put in here. These are not supposed to be here, this and this. I don't think. I think they were using it as a catch for this. So it would come around and it hit this. So I am going to see if I can find something that'll work with that. I've got these pins, which would look pretty sharp. If not, I'm just gonna have to leave the holes there. But I'm gonna take a break for a minute. I'll tell you what, the thing about steel wool, look at my arm. See that? That's why you wear gloves. So that's just the steel wool that got on my arm and fell on my arm. So I gotta go wash this stuff off. All right, I've got these screws. Go with the pins. Should be long enough. That is if it'll go through this hole here. Now I'm kind of cutting into the metal here with this screw. They look cool. Completely inappropriate, but they look cool. We're gonna be able to thread onto this guy. That guy really bit in. Yep. All right. Now let's see. Sits there. Around. I guess that's what they wanted it to do. Is that really what that was for? I guess. I like it. I like it better sitting there. So I don't know about this guy here. This one's okay. All right? Because this will stop it. Yeah, this stops it from going way far over. But this other one, he's a no. All right, let's take them off. And again, get all four screws in before you start tightening them up. Tight. 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 And tight. All right. It's kind of a good idea having that there. All right. And with that, we're done. Let's take a look. Unfortunately, it's not bright and sunny out right now. Clean this grease off. Look at that fine piece of equipment. Complete with a red cord. Looks good. This will be seeing a lot of use. My handsaw slash circular saw is an old Black & Decker that I've had for about 25 years. And you've probably seen it show up in a couple of videos. It's a little worn. So, I guess maybe that's a future project, but this guy's gonna take its place for a while. All right, that's it. This was a great project. I'd say it took me a little bit longer than I expected. Not for the mechanicals. The wiring of this, you saw, it took me no more than 30 minutes. Greasing it was pretty easy. In fact, a lot easier than on a newer one of these circular saws. I spent more time on the cosmetics of it. The front guard with all the red paint, I mean, that took a bit of time. The aluminum or aluminum alloy, I'm not really sure, but I don't think it would have ever polished up to a mirror finish, no matter how much effort I put into it. But the aluminum body of this thing, that has seen some use. It has got more dents and scratches than I've seen on any tool like this before. I think probably it was not only beat up and tossed around on the job over the last 50 or so years, but it was probably rode around in the back of a truck and people were throwing tools and wood and everything on top of it. And it's aluminum. It dents pretty easy. So, as I said, it's seen some use, but it's going to see some more use. I restored this thing to use. Please like and subscribe if you enjoyed this content. I've got more videos like this coming. And, it really helps the channel to grow. If you have already subscribed to the channel, thank you. I appreciate each and every one of you. It's the channel's doing great, and I'm having a blast doing it, and I hope you're having fun watching it. So I'm going to leave you with this, what I always say. These aren't that difficult. If you want to rebuild an old circular saw that you have, maybe it's your father's, your grandfather's, and you want to tackle it, or maybe you need one of these. I mean, you can buy a corded circular saw at a flea market or yard sale for $5, $10, $15 all day. They don't have a high resale value, which may make you think, well, why did you restore it? Well, because it's cool and it's kind of fun. It's kind of a hobby of mine. But I did restore this to use, hence why I put the 20-foot cord on it and why I was so careful to make sure it was thoroughly greased, because now it's ready to go. But you can do this. It's all basic tools, screwdrivers, wire strippers, pliers. Pretty much anyone can do this. So don't be intimidated. If you've got something like this and you want to tackle it, just go out, get busy. Take care.